स्टूडेंट्स, आई मानसी सोलंकी वेलकम्स यू इन एमवीरा ऑनलाइन स्कूल। एज वी हैव डिस्कस्ड इन आवर लास्ट वीडियो, चैप्टर नंबर 7, सिस्टम ऑफ पार्टिकल्स एंड रोटेशनल मोशन, देयर वी हैव सीन हाउ रोटेशनल मोशन अकर्स एंड डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ मोशंस अकर, व्हाट इज सिस्टम ऑफ पार्टिकल्स एंड ऑल। Today we are discussing center of mass of two particle system. Later we have discussed about the center of mass briefly. Now we are discussing about the center of mass of two particle system, a system in which there is only two particle exist. Let we have two particles m1 and m2. Here we have seen that R1 is the reference point, R1 is the position vector from the reference or origin point O. Consider a system of two point masses m1 and m2, where position vectors at time t with reference to origin are R1 and R2. Here you see R1 and R2 are the position vectors of m1 and m2. Here m1 and m2 are the two particles in a system. How two particles? Only two particles are there in a system. We can consider like hydrogen atom. In that we know there is only one proton and one neutron. So we can consider a hydrogen atom for example. Here C is the point where center of mass of the system lies. Here C is the point where center of mass of the system is lying. ठीक है, मास m1 m2 है हमारे पास, हमें नहीं पता उसका सेंटर ऑफ मास कहाँ है, एग्जैक्ट बिटवीन में हो ये कंपलसेशन नहीं है। ठीक है, तो हमने क्या लिया है, हियर इज अ पॉइंट सी, इमेजिनरी पॉइंट इन द कोऑर्डिनेट एक्सिस, दैट इज सेंटर ऑफ मास। सेंटर ऑफ मास का पोजीशन वेक्टर हमने क्या लिया है, कैपिटल आर। सी इज द पॉइंट वेयर द सेंटर ऑफ मास ऑफ द सिस्टम लाइज। ये टू पॉइंट मासेस का हमने सिस्टम लिया है, उसका सेंटर ऑफ मास का लाई करता है सी पॉइंट पे, जिसका पोजीशन वेक्टर क्या है, आर। वी आर अप्लाइंग एक्सटर्नल फोर्स F1 एंड F2 एट द पार्टिकल्स F1 एंड F2। द टोटल एक्सटर्नल फोर्स F इज गिवन बाय F1 प्लस F2। हमने दो फोर्स लगाए हैं तो टोटल फोर्स क्या होगा, F1 प्लस F2 होगा। बाय न्यूटन्स थर्ड लॉ वी नो दैट F12 इज इक्वल टू F21, दैट इज द इंटरनल फोर्सेज ऑफ पार्टिकल्स। एक्सटर्नली हमने कोई फोर्सेज लगाए हैं पार्टिकल एक दूसरे पे, इंटरनली भी जो फोर्सेज लगाएंगे रिजिड बॉडी के लिए, जो टोटल इंटरनल फोर्स होता है वो जीरो होता है। दैट मीन्स F21 प्लस F12 is equals to zero. Now we consider that criteria and we will find out how center of where the center of mass lies for the two particle system. So here we derive force, total force is given by F1 plus F2. We know that velocity is given by rate of change of displacement. Velocity is given by rate of change of displacement. For the particle m1, what is our velocity? v1 is equals to dr1 upon dt. Similarly, we can consider v2 is given by dr2 upon dt. By this, we can also conclude our momentum. Momentum is given by mass into velocity. For V1, P1 is given by M1 V1 and P2 is given by M2 V2. From this, we can put it in first. How can we put it in first? We know that rate of change of momentum, d, rate of change of momentum is given by force, by second law of motion, Newton's second law of motion, we can conclude the rate of change of momentum is given, gives us force. Till here we have derived F is given by F1 plus F2, momentum is given by M1 V1 and rate of change of momentum gives us the value of force by the second law of Newton. Now we have considered our first equation, that is f is equals to f1 plus f2. Here if I write the values of f1 and f2, what I get? D p1 upon dt plus d p2 upon dt. Rate of change of first momentum plus rate of change of second momentum gives us the force, first and second force. It can also be written as m d v1 upon dt plus m2 d v2 upon dt. Rate of change of velocity, mass into rate of change of velocity. Momentum can be written as mass of change of velocity. From this I can conclude f is given by m1 d2 upon dt square r1. We know that v1 is what? dr1 upon dt. That's why I can write it as m1 dr1 plus dt. Similarly, m2 can be written as d2 upon dt square. If I double differentiate the r1, I first get v1 and then again the derivative of v1. Since it is a constant part, I can write it as f is given by d2 upon dt square m1 r1 plus m2 r2. Multiply and divide right hand side by m1 plus m2. Here what we get? F is equals to m1 plus m2. Since it is also the constant part, then I can write it inside the differentiating part. Here we conclude m is equals to d upon dt r. What is our position vector? Double differentiating the position vector, we know that we get acceleration. Since all the quantity are constant part, we know that what is our acceleration? A is given by d2 upon dt square of r. So here we conclude acceleration, we get a term of acceleration. So what we do? We apply here the third law of motion. As by our first equation, we get acceleration is given by d2 r upon dt square. F is given by total mass into differentiation, double differentiation of the position vectors r1 and r2. Here we conclude from second law, F is equals to ma, that is force on a system is equals to total mass and the acceleration. So here I can write F is equals to total mass here m1 plus m2 and acceleration is given by d2 r upon dt square. That is our equation A. From equation A, so here what I concluded from B and D, from equation B and D, R is given by M1 R1 plus M2 R2 upon M1 plus M2. R is given by M1 R1 plus M2 R2 upon M1 plus M2. Here the position vectors of respective mass, the product of position vector of respective mass is equals to the position vector of center of mass. Here capital R is position vector for the center of mass. Okay, as we have derived, R is given by M1 R1 plus M2 R2 upon M1 plus R1. From this we can say that the position vector of system of particles is the average of the position vector of the particles of which the system is made up of. ठीक है, हम अगर पोजीशन वेक्टर निकालना है सेंटर ऑफ मास का, तो वो क्या हो रहा है, एवरेज ऑफ द पोजीशन वेक्टर्स ऑफ द पार्टिकल विद द प्रोडक्ट ऑफ देयर मासेस. सिमिलरली फ्रॉम दिस आई कैन राइट इट एज आर इंटू एम वन प्लस एम टू इज गिवन बाय एम वन आर वन प्लस एम टू आर टू. From this equation, what we have concluded that the product of position vector of center of mass and the total mass is equals to the product of masses with their position vectors individually. That is, from here we can conclude the product of position vector of center of mass and the total mass of the system is equals to the product of individual particles position vector and their masses. अगर किसी भी इंडिविजुअल पार्टिकल का पोजीशन वेक्टर और मास का अगर मैं प्रोडक्ट निकालूं तो किसके बराबर है, जो सेंटर ऑफ मास का और टोटल सेंटर ऑफ मास के पोजीशन वेक्टर और टोटल मास का. सो नाउ थिंक व्हाट हैपन इफ एम वन एंड एम टू आर ऑफ सेम मासेस. If m1 and m2 are of same masses, we know that if two objects have same masses, then their center of mass will lie in between of them. So now we can derive from this equation, is it possible or not. So r is given by, if m1 is equals to m2 is equals to m, then m plus m into r. R, what is r? Position vector of center of mass is given by m r1 plus m r2. From here 2m r is equals to m r1 plus r2. R is given by m to m cancel out, r1 plus r2 upon 2. What is r1 plus r2 by 2? That is the midpoint of the both the position vectors. And midpoint of both the position vector is what? R position vector of center of mass. So from here we can conclude when the masses of both the particles are equal, then the center of mass lies exactly between both the particles. When the masses of both the particles are equal, then the center of mass exactly between both the particles, exactly lies between both the particles. ठीक है, m1 m2 है, same masses है, दो हमने same masses consider किए तो उसका center of mass in between lie करेगा. We can know that and here we also derived it. And now if we have given the coordinates of the position of the particles. If we have given the coordinates for the position of the particles, if x1, y1, z1 and x2, y2, z2 are the coordinates of the location of two particles, then the coordinate of center of mass is given by, here if we get x1, y1, z1, x2, y2 and z2. How can we conclude x, y, z? That is the coordinate of center of mass. So here, from this equation that we have derived, we can write it that for x direction, we have what coordinates we have for the position x1 and x2. So I can write it as r is given by for x, for y and for z. X is given by m1x1 plus m2x2 upon m1 plus m2. Similarly, if y coordinates are given, then we can write it as m1y1 plus m2y2 upon m1 plus m2. Similarly, for z direction, m1z1 and m2z2 upon m1 plus m2. For this, here we only conclude the system of two particles. What happens if there is system of n particles? We know that normally we get a system of large number of particles, not only two particles. So how can we derive the center of mass for the n particles? So here we know that it is the individual products of the every particle. So if there are n number of particles, we can add their summation also here. So next we have to discuss about the center of mass for n particles. Now let us consider we have n number of particles. Here in a coordinate system we have n number of particles, m1, m2, m3, m4 till n. As we have derived r is equals to m1 r1 plus m2 r2 for two particle system. For two particle system. Now we are considering n number of particles. So here we can, by definition of center of mass, we know that center of mass is given by sum of all the masses with respect to their position vectors. So r is given by summation of mi ri, where I is equals from 1 to n, I varies from 1 to n, and similarly divided by mi, that is masses of all the individuals from I is equals to 1 to n. R is, again I can write it as r is given by m1 r1 plus m2 r2 plus m3 r3 and so on till rn. Rn what? Position vector of the nth particle divided by the masses of n elements, particles. Again, I can write it as m1 r1, m2 r2, m3 r3 upon m, capital M. Here I conclude capital M as the sum of all the masses, that is the sum of the system. Sum of the system, masses of the system, total mass of the system is capital M. So what is our center of mass of particle, n particle system? If you want to know, then you have to find it out every individual masses and the position vectors, then you can calculate the center of mass, position of center of mass. Again, if the coordinates of center of mass is x, y and z, so how can you conclude the x, y and z? Let x1, y1, z1 are the coordinates for m1. Similarly, x2, y2, z2 are for m2 and so on till mn particle, xn, yn, zn for mn particle. Then how can we conclude x coordinates? X coordinate is given by summation of m I x I divided by summation of m I from I varies from 1 to n. Similarly, for y coordinates, I can write it as summation of m I x I from 1 to n divided by summation of m I from 1 to n. And again, for the z axis, we can write it as summation of I equals to 1 to n m I z I upon summation of m I from I equals to 1 to n. Here you can find the particular coordinates of the center of mass, and you can locate the center of mass in your coordinate system x, y and z. That is, all the position are vectors are from origin. Now, as we have derived system of particles for two particle system, n particle system, now we solve a numerical. What if we have given 3 point masses of 6 gram, 4 gram and 10 gram lie at the coordinate 2, 5, minus 3, 2, 5, 7 and 4, 3, minus 1. Calculate the coordinates of center of mass of the system. So, how can we calculate? As we know, what our formula? Our formula is given by R is equals to summation of mi Ri upon summation of mi from I is equals to 1 to n. So here we have given the coordinates in x, y and z form. So what are the masses given? M1 is equals to 6 gram, M2 is equals to 4 gram and M3 is equals to 10 gram. A formula for x coordinate is given by summation of mi xi divided by summation of mi. Here I is equals to 1 to 3. Since we have 3 coordinate system and 3 particles, so we can write is I is equals to 1 to 3. So I can write the x coordinate. I can find the x coordinate by m1. Where is my m1? M1 x1 m2 x2 plus m3 x3 divided by m1 plus m2 plus m3. Here I have m1 is equals to 6 grams. X1 is what? Just write it x1, y1, z1. What is our x1? 2, 5 and minus 3. Similarly, x2, y2, z2. 2, 5 and 7. Similarly, x3, y3 and z3. 4, 3 and minus 1. So, I can write it. What is my x1? 2 plus m2, 4 grams, and x2, 2, again m3 is what? 10 grams divided by m1, m2, m3. 6 and 4, 10 and then 20. So, I can write it as 12 plus 8 plus 40 by 20, that is 60 by 20, and it is 3. So the coordinates of center of mass at x axis is 3. Similarly, we can derive for y. What is our y coordinate for center of mass? M1 y1 plus m2 y2 plus m3 y3 divided by m1 plus m2 plus m3. That is 6 multiplied by 5 plus 4 multiplied by 5 plus 3 multiplied by 10 divided by 20. here we get 30 plus 20 plus 30 by 20, that is what, 80 by 20, it's 4. Again for z, it is 6 into minus 3 plus 7 into 4 into 7 into minus 1 divided by 20. Here we get z coordinates as minus 18 plus 24 minus 10 divided by 20. Minus 28 plus 28, it comes 0. So the coordinates of center of mass is, the coordinates of center of mass x comma y comma z is equals to what, 3 comma 4 comma 0. Here like this you can solve more numericals. I hope you all get it. Now let us see some important points about center of mass. The center of mass is independent of the coordinate system. That means the coordinate system does not affect the center of mass. If it is only about x-axis or it is about y-axis. In a coordinate system, let us take the coordinate system. The position of masses are there, they all have different coordinates, but the center of mass does not depend on the coordinate system. Matlab coordinate system xyz lo, yz, x lo, okay, coordinate system aap change bhi kar sakte ho, to bhi center of mass kiske upar depend karta hai, masses ke upar. Is wajah se ye kya rahega, independent of coordinate system. The position of center of mass depends upon the shape of the body and the distribution of mass across the body. Okay, position of center of mass kiske depend karti hai, shape ke upar and distribution of masses across the body. Kitna mass puri body ke andar distribute ho rakha hai aur body ka shape kaisa hai, uske upar depend karega center of mass. Symmetric bodies in which the distribution of mass is homogeneous, the center of mass coincides with the geometric center and the center of symmetry of the body. Jo symmetric bodies hoti hai, like rectangle, triangle and all, unme hame kya milta hai, jo symmetric bodies hai, usme center of mass ka kya distribution hoga, mass ka distribution agar equal hai, to center of mass aur geometric center dono ek dusre se coincide karenge. Center of mass of a body changes its position only under translation motion but not under rotatory motion. Center of mass hai, wo only and only possible hai ke translation motion ke andar change ho. Baki jab body rotation karegi, like this pen, agar main isko rotate karwati hu, iska center of mass agar symmetric body hai, to center mein hoga, aur symmetric body hai, to agar rotatory motion ke time ye change nahi hoga, ye yahan pe nahi aayega, but it can happen in the translatory motion that center of mass of the body changes its position. Motion of center of mass. Motion, जब भी हम motion को consider करेंगे, हमें पता है कुछ ना कुछ displacement होगा, कुछ ना कुछ object की velocity होगी, acceleration होगा and all. So motion of center of mass में भी हम ये consider करेंगे कि center of mass की position क्या हमें पता है, हमने derive कर चुके हैं, उसकी velocity क्या होगी, उसका acceleration क्या होगा, force क्या लगेगा and all. We are discussing the motion of center of mass. So as we know that the position of center of mass is given by, position of center of mass is given by capital R is equals to m1r1 plus m2r2 plus m3r3 and so on till mnrn divided by m1 plus m2 plus m3 and so on till mn. So I can write it as r is given by m1 r1 plus m2 r2 plus m3 r3 plus mn rn into capital M. As we know, capital M is what? Summation of all the masses from I is equals to 1 to N. So I can write it as this. As we know, R is what? R position vector. So differentiating the above equation, with respect to time, what we can get? M dr upon dt is equals to m1 dr1 upon dt plus m2 dr2 upon dt plus m3 dr3 upon dt and so on till mn drn upon dt. We also note that the rate of change of position or displacement is given as velocity. So here we write M capital V for the velocity of center of mass. m1 v1 plus m2 v2 plus mn m3 v3 and so on till mn vn. Here from the position vector we get the velocity. The velocity of center of mass is given by sum of individual velocity of all the particles. Now again, if I differentiate the velocity, what I get? Obvious, it's an acceleration. So differentiating again, differentiating the equation with respect to time, what I get? M dv upon dt is equals to m1 d by dt of v1 plus m2 dv2 upon dt plus m3 dv3 upon dt and so on till mn dvn upon dt. Rate of change of velocity or acceleration. So acceleration is given by rate of change of velocity. So we can write this equation as ma is equals to m1a1 plus m2a2 plus m3a3 and so on till mnan. Now I can get it. This expression is reminding me something. That is what? Second law of motion. What is our second law of motion? F is equals to ma. So I can write all the individual masses into acceleration is ma is equals to f1 plus f2 plus f3 and so on. So all the forces of individual particle is equals to the total mass of the system or the center total mass of the system and acceleration of center of mass. I can also write it as एम ए इज इक्वल टू एफ नेट, वेयर एफ नेट इज इक्वल टू समेशन ऑफ एफ आई फ्रॉम आई इज इक्वल टू वन टू एन. द समेशन ऑफ फोर्सेज फ्रॉम वन टू एन इज गिवन बाय एफ नेट. एफ नेट वॉट? द टोटल फोर्स ऑन द होल बॉडी और होल ऑब्जेक्ट. नाउ व्हाट हैपन इफ टोटल फोर्स और नेट फोर्स ऑन द सिस्टम इज जीरो? इफ एफ नेट इज इक्वल्स टू जीरो, दैट द फोर्स अप्लाइड ऑन द होल सिस्टम इज जीरो. दैट मीन्स F1 is equals to 0, F2 is equals to 0 and so on, Fn is equals to 0. No, it is not compulsory that if Fnet is 0, then F1, F2, Fn and all the system, some particles have no force. Some forces are cancelled out, some are of positive quantity and some are for negative quantity. So the direction of all the forces are not in same, that's why the F net is zero. But that doesn't mean the magnitude of forces, individual forces, is zero. If I am applying here, this gives me MA is equals to zero, mass of the system cannot be zero, that gives us acceleration of center of mass is equals to zero. Acceleration of center of mass is zero. किसी भी ऑब्जेक्ट का सेंटर ऑफ मास जीरो कब होता है? द सेंटर ऑफ मास ऑफ एनी बॉडी और सिस्टम इज द सेंटर, द एक्सेलरेशन ऑफ सेंटर ऑफ मास ऑफ एनी सिस्टम इज जीरो. दैट मीन्स ए वन इज इक्वल्स टू जीरो, ए टू इक्वल्स टू जीरो, ए थ्री इक्वल्स टू जीरो, ए एन इक्वल्स टू जीरो. नो, इफ द acceleration of center of mass is zero, then it is not necessary or compulsory that the individual particle is not having any acceleration. If the acceleration is constant, we know that if acceleration is zero, that means velocity is constant. So here we get acceleration of center of mass is zero. This gives us velocity of center of mass is constant. Okay, from here we conclude if F net, total force on any system, is zero, that doesn't mean that individual forces are zero on the particles. Or if F net is zero, then it gives that mass, total mass into acceleration is also zero. Acceleration, total mass cannot be zero, so acceleration of center of mass we can let it as zero. If center of acceleration of center of mass is zero, that means the velocity of center of mass is constant. But it doesn't mean that acceleration of individual particle is zero. So from motion of center of mass we can conclude, first from our equation of position vector we can conclude the velocity of the center of mass, then from velocity of center of mass we can conclude the acceleration of center of mass, and then we find out the relation between F net, total force on the system, and the acceleration of center of mass. From here we conclude that if F net is zero, agar main total force kisi object ka zero kar do, to what will we get? We get that acceleration of center of mass is also zero, but that means velocity of center of mass is constant, but that doesn't mean the forces of individual particle is zero or center of acceleration of individual particle is zero. So from here what we have concluded? From here we have concluded that if F net is zero for a system, that is the total force on the system is zero, then the acceleration of center of mass is also zero, and the velocity of center of mass is constant, or second thing what we concluded from here, we have concluded that if F net is zero on any system, that doesn't mean that the force on the individual particle is zero. Or the acceleration of each particle is also not equals to zero. Each particle have some of their acceleration, some forces on that, and for F net is zero, that doesn't mean the individual particle has zero force, total force is zero on the individual particle, or the acceleration of each particle is not zero. Now let us take a system was initially at rest. A system was initially at rest. Initially at rest, that means V initial, initial velocity of center of mass is equals to zero. If the initial velocity of center of mass is zero and F net is also equals to zero, F net, that means the total force on the system is also equals to zero. The total force on the system is also zero, and initially the system is at rest. Rest means V initial is equals to zero. Velocity of center of mass at initially is zero and F net is zero. So what we have concluded? If F net is zero, we know that acceleration of center of mass is zero. Acceleration of center of mass is zero. That means velocity is constant. If velocity is constant, initially we have seen that the velocity is at, the velocity of center of mass is what? Zero. And velocity is constant. This gives us velocity finally of center of mass is also zero. Okay. If acceleration of center of mass is zero, that doesn't mean the velocity of center of mass is zero. The velocity of center of mass is constant. But that is only special case when the system was initially at rest. When the system was initially at rest, velocity of initial center of mass is zero. Total force applied on the system is also zero. That gives us acceleration of center of mass is zero. Acceleration is zero. That means velocity constant. And if the velocity constant, what we have initial velocity, if velocity is constant, that the velocity is initially we have having, we get that same velocity at the final position. When a system was initially at rest, V initially is equals to 0 and V final of center of mass is also 0. Here I completed this session. Thank you all.